For the last few years, I've really been interested in this concept. It's called the exposome. And this is an idea that was first presented by Chris Wild, who's the director at IARC. And he was very upset that so much energy and effort was going into looking at genetic causes of cancer, when in fact it appears that the environmental, as the non-genetic factors, are at least as important and probably more important. So he came up with this idea of the exposome, basically as an analog to the genome, which would give people something they could start shooting for, and eventually coming up with a GWAS for environmental factors. Now, of course, the exposome being everything, everywhere, all the time, and everybody is probably too big to shoot for. So my colleague Martin Smith here at Berkeley and I tried to functionalize this exposome idea and bringing it down to the biological level. So we conceptualized that the exposome represents everything that we have inside our bodies. So the cells and the critical molecules in our bodies are being exposed continuously, and it's that exposure that we really need to focus in on. Some of those exposures are going to be exogenous. They're going to be coming from air pollution, water pollution, et cetera. But some of them are going to be generated inside our bodies by the microbiome, for example, or by oxidative processes that take place all the time. So the exposome is really a very, very big idea, and it's important in the sense that it makes the environment much more relevant to health. So rather than thinking of environment in terms of just what we might be exposed to from factories or cars emitting pollution, it's saying we need to think in much more global terms. So there's lots of things. There's lots of things. There are reactive electrophiles that I'm going to be talking about more specifically. There's this thing called the metabolome, which is all the small molecules in the body, lipids, sugars, nucleotides, amino acids, metabolites, xenobiotics, inflammation markers, cytokines, chemokines, etc. These are very reactive molecules that have important biological effects. They're small molecules. Receptor binding agents, things like hormones, xenoestrogens, endocrine disruptors, of course, metals, drugs. Essentially all pharmaceutical products are small molecules. Micronutrients, and then again these microbiome products. Microbiome, for those of you who aren't familiar with the term, is what we used to call the gut flora, although the microbiome includes all the bacteria in and on the body. And it's been estimated there's about 1 million genes in the microbiome. 1 million genes. How many do we have as human beings? 23,000. So the microbiome has 50 times more genes. What do those genes do? They produce chemicals. One gene, one molecule. So you've got 1 million molecules that are being produced by these bacteria that are inside our bodies. What happens to those molecules? Well, they don't go where you think they go. They actually go back into the host. They go back into us. They go into our blood. In fact, about 25% of all the energy that we get is coming from the microbiome. So we're like cows in a sense. We are digesting our food in part with our gut bacteria. So the microbiome is an incredibly important thing. It probably is the most important factor in establishing the child's immune system. So it might be very important to leukemia. A child's immune system is set really in the first 6 months of life. And do you know that when you're born, you're sloshing out of this tube and you're sloshing in a mixture of what? Bacteria. So it's the mother's feces and vaginal bacteria. And that's what is inoculating your microbiome when you're born, all of us. And it's probably for very important evolutionary reasons, because those bacteria that you're going to get from your mother are probably the best ones for you to get started in life. And there's interesting evidence that babies of cesarean, and they're born by cesarean, have a different microbiome that's coming mainly from the mother's skin. And these babies tend to have, based on small sample sizes so far, but they tend to have problems with autoimmune responses later in life and a lot of infections early in life. So the microbiome could be the next big thing, and it's something that we need to start thinking about. And the thing about the serum exposome is that it includes a lot of the fingerprints from the microbiome. So we can get evidence about the microbiome by measuring these small molecules in blood. Enough of that. So we have the serum exposome. What would we use that for if we really wanted to understand the cause of disease? We're going to study disease etiology, not preventing disease at this point, but just finding out where it comes from. Well, this is a discovery process. And to do discovery, for genetic factors, we've used GWAS. Now I'm saying let's use something else. We'll call it EWAS, for exposome-wide association studies. And how would we do that? Well, the best way to do it, I think, is to use epidemiology, to use your populations to discriminate the factors that are important for establishing disease from the ones that probably aren't. So you could take diseased and healthy populations. You get samples of blood or serum from these two populations, and you would do what we call an untargeted analysis. So you'd look for as many chemicals of a particular class as you possibly can. And in this untargeted design, you would not even necessarily know exactly which chemicals you're measuring. You just know that you can reproducibly measure whatever these entities are. In this kind of study, they usually refer to these chemicals as features, so they don't, because they don't know the identities necessarily. So you look for discriminating features, those that are different between the cases and the controls. And when you find discriminating features, that's when you get interested in what they are. So you may measure 100,000 chemicals, but maybe only 1,000 of them or 500 of them really seem to have any difference between cases and controls. So you want to find out what those 500 chemicals are. So you identify them, and then you would classify those as candidate biomarkers for really trying to understand disease etiology or even disease prevention and diagnosis later. So with these candidate biomarkers, you would then get a second set of samples from diseased and healthy subjects. And here, if you could get samples from prospective cohorts, it would be much more powerful because these would be samples that were collected prior to disease diagnosis. And here you would employ targeted designs. That is, there are 500 things, say, that you're interested in at this point. Well, you look at those 500 things and not the 100,000 that you measured initially. And if you find that there's still an association with disease in these samples that were collected prior to diagnosis, then you say, well, you must be onto something that's really related to an exposure that may be causative for disease. And we could call those biomarkers of exposure. If not, if you see that they showed up in the case control study, but they're not necessarily showing up in the prospective cohort study, then you'd say, well, then maybe they're biomarkers that are related to this disease progression. Still important, still useful, but different class of biomarkers. So we'll just call these biomarkers of exposure and biomarkers of disease. And this is the important thing, is to get those biomarkers, because once you've got them, then you can start using them for all sorts of different applications. But now things change. So we're moving away from this sort of discovery process, this data-driven process, to one that's knowledge-driven, hypothesis testing. These are the kinds of things that we're used to doing all the time. The problem is these particular methods are not very useful for finding out what the causes are, these multifactorial disease processes, when there are hundreds of thousands of different possibilities. We guess that PBDEs might be important, but are those the most important things? Don't know. We need to have a more sort of agnostic approach as a first step. But once we know that we're onto something, then this knowledge-driven design becomes critical. So what do? We do molecular epidemiology. We try to work out the dose response between the biomarker and the clinical outcome. We do what I call exposure biology. So we want to find the sources of exposure. We want to measure the magnitudes of exposure relative to these sources. Systems biology, where we start to compare the omic signatures that we're getting from EWAS with genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, etc. And at this point, we can start looking at these biomarkers of disease and thinking about how they can be used in diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment of the disease. Again, system biology is a key to being able to do this. And also, the big money interests, drug development would come in at this point, and they would start to see these biomarkers of disease as very useful and potentially profitable for developing new drugs. Okay, so that's it. We take the serum exposome, we identify biomarkers of exposure, biomarkers of disease, and we use those in meaningful ways to understand the causes of disease and to diagnose and treat diseases. Again, it's these biomarkers that are the key elements.